Welcome. I'm here with Rachel Bloom. How you doing?
Hi, nice to be with you today. How are you?
Ready to answer some questions?
Yes, absolutely. Let's go.
What are your opinions on the article recently published about your connection with Planned Parenthood and the allegations you're facing?
All right, so this article is clearly an attack on my integrity, and it's an attack on women's access to health care. And women's access to healthcare is something that I'm very passionate about, and the fact that the GOP continues to have this smear campaign against Planned Parenthood is really saddening to me. I thought that we were past this. I thought that this was 2015. I didn't realize that we were going back in time like this. And again, I support what they do, and I think that it's really unfortunate that they have to attack women's rights when they clearly have the right to privacy, they have the right to their own bodies, and it's really, really saddening to me.
Why do you feel so strongly about not defunding Planned Parenthood?
You know, Planned Parenthood does valuable, valuable work, and its work is necessary. There are women in low-income areas, metropolitan areas, where Planned Parenthood is the only place that they can go to get their pap smears, to get their breast exams, to get contraception. That's the only place that they can go. Planned Parenthood has other valuable services, such as STD testing for men and women, and they also are the nation's leading source of sex education. In our schools, they're the leading source, and that's something that affects everyone, not just women. What they do is very, very valuable.
What role does Planned Parenthood play in your campaign?
I've always been a strong supporter of Planned Parenthood. I've always been a strong supporter of women's rights. I've always been a strong supporter of women in politics. That's something I've always been passionate about, and I will continue to support them. They receive no federal funding for abortions. Those services are off to the side, and those are only 3% of what they do. So the fact that there is this smear campaign led by my opponent and the GOP is saddening to me, because what they do is very, very valuable.
There's been a lot of rumors that Planned Parenthood has donated to your campaign. Are these rumors true?
No, these are not true. As I am a staunch supporter, I have not received any kind of financial donations to my campaign from Planned Parenthood, because most of my donations are actually from middle-class families. They're from women, from men, from small business owners, from people who really like what I did in Ohio and like the regulations that and the things that I did in Ohio, and they support me. And I fund my own campaign with my own money, because that's really something that I'm passionate about. And when I was a young woman, I worked hard, I earned my money, I started my own businesses, and that's how I came to be financially stable and where I am today, so that I can run the campaign that I want to run.
Right. Have you been influenced by money in the past to promote yourself?
I think everyone wants to make money, and that's what I did as a young girl. I made a lot of money, and I was hardworking and passionate about what I did. As far as campaign donations, I think that is something that we need to reevaluate. Campaign donations from large pharmaceutical companies, from military contracting companies, those are lobbies that hurt the American people more than help them. What I'm passionate about is the American people, and I think that small donations from individuals, from families, those are really what need to be funding campaigns now, and that's what I'm passionate about.
Right. What is your relationship to Sarah Parker?
Sarah Parker is the head of Planned Parenthood in Ohio. She is a wonderful woman. She has led women's rights for as long as I can remember. She has been hardworking. She makes sure that women who cannot access health care have access to the services they need, to pap smears, to breast exams, to contraception. That's what she does, and I'm always going to have a relationship with her, because I want to see what she does with her finances, where our federal tax dollars are going. I want to see where the state and local government is putting that money. What are they using it for? That's really what I'm trying to do with my relationship with her.
Were you aware of the damaging personal information that was between your chief of staff and Sarah Parker about Ms. DiMeo?
I wasn't aware of any damaging information regarding Ms. DeMio. She is a wonderful woman, and I'm always going to support any woman in politics, regardless of whether they're Democrat or Republican. I did not agree with the piece of legislation that she was putting on the floor to defund Planned Parenthood. I then had a meeting with her, which I've had several meetings with all kinds of sponsors of bills, to let her know that I would be vetoing this bill if it got to my desk. And I think that, you know, she understood my position on the bill, and that may have influenced her.
How did you not know if you were copied on some of the emails?
I wasn't aware of any emails. Again, I would check the source of the article. It's obviously a third-party source, which has, or it's not been verified. So unverified sources making claims can be very dangerous.
Why did you meet with Ms. DeMio privately?
Again, it's kind of a part of my everyday duties as the governor of Ohio to take meetings with sponsors of bills and talk about these bills. And after we had our meeting, she then decided, you know, given the circumstances of what was happening and my strong stance on vetoing this bill, she decided that it would be better after my campaign and after I left office.
Is there anything else you would like to the public to know?
I just really want them to know who I am as a candidate and what I stand for. Women's issues are, of course, very important to me. But there's a lot of really important issues that, unfortunately, because of this smear campaign against Planned Parenthood and against women's access to health, I haven't been able to talk about. I want a chance to talk about education. I want a chance to talk about ending the war on drugs, ending the extreme rate of incarceration for young black men in America. That's something I'm passionate about, and unfortunately, I'm kind of being pigeonholed as this women's rights issue campaign, and I have so much to say. I have so much to say about the middle class and the economy, and I really hope that we can move past this and move on to some other important things that the American people care about, and right. That's what I'm excited about.
Right. Well, thank you for your time today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am Chad Marino, and this is Senator Chuck Franklin, and today I will be conducting an interview regarding allegations made against Senator Franklin about an extramarital relation. Senator Franklin, how long have you and your wife been married?
I've been happily married to my wife for 22 years.
Okay, have you ever had any prior issues in your marriage?
Besides who cooked dinner that night, not really.
Awesome. Have you ever had an affair with your wife or anyone in a prior relationship?
Absolutely not. It's the sanctity of marriage. It's taken way too seriously to the two of us.
Going off of that, what do you make of the allegations that have been made about the Ashley Madison website?
I make the claims are almost laughable. I mean, when I first heard it was something, a bit of ridiculousness to me because it's just blatantly false. I love my family and I love the morals that I was raised on, these strong Christian values that our country was also raised on too much.
Then, who is Marie Hunter and what is your relationship with her?
I was hoping you could tell me more about that, because prior to this ridiculous claim, I have no idea who she was.
Marie Hunter is the female who is making these allegations against you. To clarify things, you've never had an affair with Marie Hunter?
No, absolutely not.
One of our sources have noticed that you and your wife haven't really been traveling together on the campaign trail. Is this due to these allegations of the extramarital relations, or is this something different?
I'm not entirely sure where your source has been, but my wife has been with me every step of the way.
Okay. And are you, another source has found information that you might are also currently be sleeping with someone on your campaign trail. Is this true or not?
That is definitely not true, and I would definitely like to know who that would be.
What do you make of the allegations that your wife is consensual with this relationship with Marie Hunter?
As I said earlier, I had no idea who she was, and I would hope my wife says the same.
Finally, are you worried that these allegations are going to be damning to your future goals?
Absolutely not. I think the American people understand that this was people on my staff who didn't fully understand the consequences of their actions. I think there are way worse allegations such as blackmailing and strong-arming fellow Americans to get your personal agenda out. That should be way more considered.
And finally, are you concerned at all that some of the American people might have you found guilty in the court of public opinion? or already have, you know, conceptions made about you?
Absolutely not. I think the people understand that these are situations that happen to a lot of people. It just so happens that the people that get caught in the limelight are the people that get caught in the crossfire.
Awesome. Well, that's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you.
I was born and raised in a small town in Ohio by a middle-class family. My mother was a teacher, and my father was a factory worker. So I grew up knowing a lot about what it means to be an average American. I've had to work hard to be where I am today because I believe that's the American way. Every day, we are faced with new challenges to overcome. And as your president, I will see these challenges as opportunities to build a better future for America. I'm Rachel Bowman, and I approve this message.
I tried just doing one, maybe I should. wouldn't have picked you. It would
have been great.
It would have been real funny if everybody would have been like, you know what? No, I don't think you're ready.
Could you imagine in class if that happened to somebody? I feel like that would crush their spirit.
I'm going to give me a no. It's a no for me. One, two, three, four.
Welcome.
We're actually streaming this live. I'm waiting for my production chief. They're all looking at you, Jennifer. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We are so excited that you're here. The presidential debate 2015. Please give yourselves a round of applause. We are so excited about tonight, about the debate that is sure to hold some fireworks and some fascinating conversation. I hope that you're ready to hear it all. To kick us off tonight, it is my great honor to introduce the president of St. Leo University, Dr. Bill Lennox.
Happy St. Leo Day. Well, good evening, and welcome to our St. Leo debate. This is a great opportunity for us. St. Leo's been out on the cutting edge of teaching for a long time. You know, I think back to 1973 when we went out to the Army, when it wasn't Air Force, when it wasn't very popular to be with the military. I can think of the late 90s when we went online, one of the first institutions to do that. And this is just one more step. This is experiential learning, learning that goes on outside of the classroom. Students could learn all of this information by sitting, taking notes in a lecture hall, but they really don't learn it the way they are tonight. It's a great opportunity to continue the cutting edge teaching that St. Leo has been a part of for a long time. And we just take a look around. Tonight, we have students from the political science group, and they're the ones that form the parties and the platform and have the candidates. Multimedia that's putting this on, criminal justice doing the security, the comms people out there that are talking to the newspapers and talking to the candidates. So this is really a great opportunity for experiential learning across the board and not just for the candidates that you're gonna see tonight. I wanna just tip my hat to two people. First, Rachel Bowman and Chuck Franklin. It takes a lot of guts to get up here and answer questions. So hats off to the faculty that were involved in it, that dedicated their time to it, the staff that was involved, particularly in the back rooms taking care of things, the students who gave their time, hats off to you, and to Jeff Borden, the work that he's done as the Chief Innovation Officer bringing this to us. So sit back and enjoy experiential learning. Enjoy.
Okay, so here we go. This event is being streamed live. I understand we have 12,000 viewers right now, 12,150 or so viewers. So please note that whatever happens here in the room is being experienced all across America and possibly beyond. At the same time, we are going to get started. Are you ready? Okay. I am going to turn the proceedings over to our moderators. They are going to handle things until the very end. We will be voting tonight, so just make sure you've got your device handy, because that's what we're gonna use in order to vote when we're all said and done. But for now, I'll turn it over to our moderators who will begin tonight's debate.
Good evening, and welcome to the first and only presidential debate of 2016.
sponsored by the Commission on Presidential Debates. I am Bethany Reynolds, and I am honored to moderate this debate along with Brittany Ganey and Rebecca Masano. This evening's debate is divided between domestic and foreign policy issues. We're going to move back and forth between foreign and domestic, since that is what will be required of you in your role as president. Each candidate will have 1 minute to answer the question posed and 1 minute for a response. Neither of the candidates nor the campaigns have had access to the questions. We ask our audience at St. Leo to please remain quiet during the question and answer session, but you are welcome to show your enthusiasm right now as we welcome Republican candidate Senator Charles Franklin. And Democratic candidate Governor Rachel Bowman. We will begin the opening statements, first from Senator Franklin, followed by Governor Bowman.
All right, so before I get started, I would just like to say or request for a moment of silence for the atrocities that are currently unfolding right now in France. So if everyone please. Thank you. My fellow Americans, thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Senator Chuck Franklin, and I'm here to talk to you about the matters facing this country today. Tonight is not a night of right versus wrong between myself and Governor Bowman, but rather a debate of fundamental issues and their priorities today. Our administration understands the importance of American philosophies on situations such as small businesses, personal freedoms, and education. We are not afraid to remind Americans that the Constitution is here to limit government and not the people themselves. Under the current administration, we've had multiple international threats against the United States that have gone uncontested and placed on the back burner of importance. The Franklin and Chase administration will let those who threaten the United States know that there is a line they will not cross without American action. We'll help to stabilize and boost our economy to bring us to the level that we should be, the top of the international economy. Together, we can jumpstart the education program, which is well overdue. I think a question Americans need to ask themselves is, are we doing as well as we could be, as well as we should be? I think if we plan to restore and maintain ourselves as the global leader and global icon of greatness and opportunity, then the answer to those questions is a simple no. We're a great country, but we can be better, which is why I'm here today, to let you know that leadership is not about me, it's about our country. Thank you.
Thank you. And I want to thank you, Chuck Franklin, for that moment of silence for Paris, because we are not alone in this. And as somebody who has loved ones in Paris right now, I thank you for that. I'm Rachel Bowman. I'm just a small town girl from Ohio. My father, who's here tonight, was a factory worker, and my mother is a teacher. My husband is here as well, but our beautiful daughter is studying for exams at the moment, so she couldn't be here. I'm so honored that St. Leo would host this debate tonight, and I'm excited to talk about the issues. I'm excited to talk about my time in government, my time as the governor of Ohio. I restored our economy in Ohio. I fought for teachers to have the increased salary that they deserve, because I know what it's like having my mother be a teacher. I know what the American dream is. I put myself through college, and I believe that every single one of you deserve to have a chance at that American dream. I'm asking you to put any notions of policies or predetermined parties behind you tonight, and think about the issues. Think about who you would want in the office as your president. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. Governor Bowman, having won the coin toss, the first question is for you. The Taliban appears to be regrouping in the in Afghanistan. ISIS controls large tracts in Iraq and Syria, And in light of today's events in Paris, is the war on terror winnable? And how can we continue to justify spending resources on this fight when progress seems so hard to attain?
Thank you. And in light of the events tonight, I understand. I understand your concern. I feel it too. We all feel it. We are citizens not only of America, but we are citizens of the world. I think that the best way we can go against those who seek to instill fear in us is by being united. This was not just an attack on Paris. This was an attack on us all. This was an attack on freedom. This was an attack on religious freedom. This was an attack on every one of us, on our children. This war against terror can never truly be won, because once we stomp out one flame, another will ignite. But that doesn't mean that we can just let this happen. That doesn't mean that we can just let innocent lives be lost. We must stand together in an international anti-terror cooperation. We must stand shoulder to shoulder with France, with Great Britain, because we are allies and we will stand up for freedom. That is who we are. We will stand for freedom. And we will show the people who carried out this attack that we will not be shaken. We will not be made afraid, because we believe in freedom. Thank you.
This is very well said. Even President Obama said today, ISIS is no longer a threat. And lo and behold, we have examples today. Earlier this morning, Vladimir Putin recognized the situations that were going on and said, I will stand shoulder to shoulder, like Governor Bowman said, with the United States. The war on terror is winnable, but not in the methods that we've been taking. The terrorist groups are hydra heads. You take one out, two more come up. But it's a method of containment. It's not a method of destruction. Like I said, the war on terror is winnable, but it's a unified front that we need in order to stop it. Thank you.
This question is again starting with you, Governor Bowman. You have spent your entire political career in Ohio. Do you feel that you have the foreign policy expertise necessary to fulfill your role as head of state?
Absolutely. And I do understand that concern, because I started off as a small business owner. I grew my businesses myself. And so I do have a great amount of knowledge when it comes to the economy, and that's where my strength is. But listen, I have an amazing running mate in Christopher Sampson. He is a Vietnam War vet. He has worked in foreign policy his entire life. He has experienced what it is to be in war. He knows the sacrifice that has to be made when we send our troops to a foreign land. He knows what we have to do to take care of our veterans when they come back home. He will head up the fight to reform the VA. That's his number one, duty as soon as he gets into office. And I'm excited for that.
I myself am a veteran of Desert Storm, so I understand the service needed to deal with certain foreign affairs. You know, I've served this country in boots overseas, and with everyone's help, I can continue to serve this country from the Oval Office. I wholeheartedly understand and believe that I do have the foreign affairs experience necessary.
Thank you. This question will begin with you, Senator Franklin. Having served in Desert Storm, what standard would you use to determine whether to deploy troops to solve international conflicts?
American troops will not be deployed unless every other avenue has been exhausted. Putting boots on the ground is an absolute worst case scenario, because those are still American lives at the end of the day. These are not just figures and numbers to be thrown around, to throw into different countries. So until every other option has been exhausted, that is the measure that I'll take to send troops.
Thank you, and I commend you for that. I would take that one step further and just remind us all
that we are, again, a part of a global community. And what really makes America strong is that when we're united with our allies, we need to protect our interests. We need to protect our neighbors. I, as your president, am determined to protect America, to protect our people, and to protect our interests. We have to protect our children here at home just as much as we have to protect our borders from those who seek to destroy us. We must think of the struggles that we're facing here at home. 1 in 4 children live below the poverty line. Those are children who don't have access to health care. Those are children who don't have access to education, the quality of education that they need.
Thank you. We are now going to bring Brittany Ganey to ask questions about education policy.
First, Governor Bowman. How do you define success in the education system? And how do you measure progress towards that vision of success?
Absolutely. Thank you for that question. And being the daughter of an educator, I do have special insight to this. And I know that it's impossible to measure intellect by a standardized test. Standardized tests are necessary, but they are not the end all be all. We need to allow teachers to have freedom to teach how they want to teach while teaching to the standards that will allow America to be competitive economically on the global scale. And I believe that education is really the way to accomplish great things. When we invest in our children, we invest in our economy. The children of this world will carry out research that will help us to end global warming. The children of our nation will help us to eliminate diseases.
I personally believe that you can measure success in the classroom by how dedicated and interested students are. With the current programs we have right now, such as Common Core, they don't get that interest. Common Core right now is the federal government sticking their hands into everyday Americans and saying, look, this is what you're going to teach and this is how you're going to teach it. That there's no way to measure success that way, especially in a classroom. So what we need to do is we need to get students more interested in what they're learning and find new ways for them to learn more about it. We need more ways to promote vocational schools and technical schools. We need more people that are interested in things such as being a mechanic or being an electrician. I mean, even Jesus was a carpenter. We need situations like that. That's how you measure success, through interest.
I would say that if you want to accomplish all the things that you've just talked about accomplishing, we need to invest in our teachers. Our teachers are not paid enough. Our teachers are underappreciated and underpaid. They need the support to be able to push those kids to follow whatever dream that they have, whether that be in a technical program or going on to the university. So my challenge would be to you is if you want all these things to happen, why aren't you pushing for teachers to be paid more?
Teachers absolutely should be paid more, but however, teachers should also teach what they want. There was a protest just outside, just before this, that said, let teachers teach. Don't let them just translate what the federal government wants them to translate. That's not their job. Their job is to educate students.
I'm not telling teachers how to teach. I'm telling them that there are certain things that students must know to be successful.
I think with your support of Common Core, that's exactly
what
you're
doing. We're going to move on to the next question.
Thank you.
Senator Franklin, your running mate has said that if you know a child's zip code, you can predict the type of education that child will receive.
Mm-hmm.
With this in mind, are you in favor of a greater nationalization of an education system, including the implementation of a national curriculum? Or are you in favor of decentralizing the education system further and even providing incentives for charter schools and voucher systems?
I am 100% in favor of decentralizing it because I believe every state in the United States should have their own curricula. They should be able to teach what they teach and how they teach it. My running mate was correct that if you can tell the type of education someone will get from their zip code, it's sad. I'm also a very strong supporter of things such as school choice. If people understand that the only school near them is a failing school, a parent should have the right to send their kid to whatever school they would like to within reason. I think voucher programs are a great idea. They help support students that are interested in what they want to learn.
My question to my opponent is, why wouldn't he want to increase the level of education for all students? Only he's saying he wants to increase the level of education for some special students. I disagree with that. I shouldn't be able to tell the quality of a student's education based on their zip code. We need to have amazing quality teachers in every single school. We need to be able to provide to our students what they need. Just because someone is born into poverty does not mean that they should not receive the same quality of education as anyone else. And my question to you is, why do you think that this policy that you're promoting will help any student, if not all students, to receive a better education?
Governor Bowman, I don't entirely think you understand what I'm saying here. I'm saying that I think if a student wants to learn something that is outside of their physical range, outside of where they live, then I think they should be entitled to with voucher programs and school choice. I think this isn't just going to help gifted students. This is going to help any student. It's going to help students interested in things that most schools can't offer sometimes, such as technical schools.
Quality education is a human right.
I agree with you. I don't understand where this point is coming from.
We're going to move on to the next question now.
Thank you.
Governor Bowman, politicians often talk in generalities about improving education in the country. Should you win, what is the first concrete thing you will do to reform the system?
Like I said, I think teachers are underpaid, undersupported. I see firsthand just how hard teachers work. Teachers don't work 9 in the morning to 4 in the afternoon. Teachers start working the moment they wake up, and they continue working late into the night, grading papers, taking the extra steps to make sure that your children receive quality education. I believe the best way that we can show our appreciation for our teachers is by providing more than just a living wage for them. Teachers in other societies, in other cultures, in other countries such as Norway and Denmark are paid what they deserve. They are paid what we pay doctors. And I stand behind that.
Teachers throughout the United States are all paid separately. Teachers in Connecticut and New York are obviously paid noticeably more than teachers in areas such as Wyoming and Montana. Thank you. I think we can have a reform from this program by allowing them to teach what they would like to teach, not, like I said, not translating for the federal government. With the programs with Common Core, there's no say anymore. We're one step away from just letting computers teach our students. And that's an elimination of an entire program of a career that would just be eliminated, and that's not right. With my reform, I would go back to the traditional concept of allowing teachers to continue operating in their classroom how they've been operating for decades in America, for centuries.
What do you say about southern states that are falling farther and farther behind their counterparts?
In terms of academics?
In terms of academics, in terms of paying their teachers enough. You can't say that this system is working when it's not working. That's false. You can't continue to say that a system that is not functioning to its full ability is working when it's not.
Governor Bowman, I just have a question. You keep saying to pay teachers more is part of the answer, but what about teachers who aren't dedicated to teaching anymore? Is money still that answer?
Listen, when you offer a living, more than a living wage, when you offer a significant salary, then you are going to attract quality teachers. Teaching is an act of love, yes, but many people choose not to get into teaching because they have to provide for their families. These are people who would make fantastic teachers, but because maybe they have 4 children at home, they simply cannot afford to be a teacher. And that's something that I think needs to be corrected immediately.
I believe that upping the salary of teachers, obviously, yes, some teachers would love that, but at the same time, you're not recruiting teachers at that point, you're recruiting people who like money. And I think that that's a big issue in education, because if teachers right now, with the payment that they have, if they didn't like their job, if they didn't like their pay, then they would leave. But with their pay, they still love their job, and that's why they're still here today.
Since we're on the topic of money,
I think that's fundamentally wrong.
Since we're on the topic of money, we're going to bring in Rebecca Masano to ask questions about economy.
Senator Franklin, while the Great Recession appears to be over, economic growth does not appear to be returning to the levels we have enjoyed in the post-World War II era. What will your administration do to grow the economy?
First and foremost, my administration has a two-step plan to help lower the small business tax from 19.5 to 15%. With this deduction, we can help promote more jobs more American jobs, and help pay circulate more money into the economy. We would also incentivize large companies to stop outsourcing and bring American jobs back to the United States, back to America. And ultimately, we would start investigating into the Keystone Pipeline, which not only would that supply 9,000 jobs, it would, after its completion, would have over five times that amount.
Senator Bowman?
All right, thank you for this question. We have seen growth, but maybe not the level of growth that we would desire. As being the small business owner that I was when I first started out, I understand all of the red tape that you have to go through when you are starting your small business. And I think that we need to cut taxes for the middle class. We also need to incentivize corporations to keep our jobs at home. But I would go one step further. I think that we need to close the excessive loopholes for corporations and excessive exemptions. They are costing America our future. Economically, we cannot continue down this road where a small percentage owns the vast majority and the middle class are suffering because of it. I'm asking corporations to pay what is due.
Senator Franklin, part of your platform is to cut taxes for small businesses and middle classes. Can you just expound on that a little bit in regards to this question?
In terms of how?
In terms of what is your plan for that? How are you going to cut those taxes? Like, what is that going to look like to bring it down from, I believe you said 19.5
to 15%. To 15%.
Yes. Can you just give us a little bit more detail into that?
So with cutting those taxes, we'll promote more income for those small businesses, thus supplying more income to any jobs or any new workers that they would employ. So with that, we can create more jobs and create more money circulating to the United States economy.
I would add that if we do cut down on excessive exemptions for big corporations, we will generate $900 billion for our economy that we can put into education, that we can put into making America better. I don't understand why my opponent wants to continue down this road that we're going. He is perfectly all right with allowing big corporations to profit off the people who are working so hard for them without sharing any of the earnings. That's wrong.
I mean, I believe I just said that I would also incentivize big corporations to stop outsourcing, to bring jobs back to the United States. It's not a matter of taking advantage of the American people. It's a matter of taking advantage of the system. Thank you.
We're going to move on to the next question.
Since President Obama has taken office, the national debt has increased by almost $8 trillion. The total debt per taxpayer works out to over $150,000. Still, some economists argue that more spending is needed to increase growth and create jobs. How would a Bowman administration handle this issue?
Listen, I don't think that more spending is necessarily the best option. I think that allowing our workers to get to work is the best option. I think that having a minimum wage of $12 on the federal level is something that would allow everyone to be able to make enough to have a living income. The more that corporations pay the people who work for them, the less that the government has to subsidize things like housing, food stamps. So really, we're taking that pressure off of you, off of the American people, and putting it on who it's due to, the corporations who are making money and not paying their fair share.
First and foremost, I think that minimum wage should obviously be a state right. It's called minimum wage for a reason. If it meant to be a working living wage, it would be called a living wage or livable wage. minimum wage state by state is necessary, because obviously it's more expensive to live in New York City than it is, like I said, to live in a much cheaper state, let's say Wyoming or Montana. I keep bringing them up. Ultimately, I think we can create, we need to stop lending more money to countries that are not the United States, that are not America, because that's not solving our problem. We're too much in debt. We're just throwing money at this point. The economy is a real, living, breathing thing that people just don't understand. It's not intangible. We need to understand that our tax code, you should not need a law degree to understand how your economy operates, to understand all the tax codes that are currently in place.
I would just like to mention that minimum wage across the board, nobody is going to be living in excess, living on $12 an hour. That's just enough to get by. No one should be living in poverty who is working 40 hours a week. That's just realistic. It's not idealistic, it's realistic.
We're gonna move on to the next question.
Senator Franklin, in 1968, the federal minimum wage was worth well over $10 in 2015.
Dollars.
71% of Americans say they would support an increase in minimum wage to $10.10 that the Obama administration proposed. Do you agree with the majority of Americans that the minimum wage should be increased?
I believe with the concept that if a state by state decide that they want to raise their minimum wage, that's an entirely different issue. But I don't believe the federal government should have a say in how much a minimum wage worker would make. I believe, you know, that should be up to the Connecticut state government or the Florida state government to say how much the Connecticut and the Florida workers would make. At the end of the day, minimum wage payments are for different types of jobs. It's not, you're not working out in a field making $8 an hour again. The amount of money you're making would fluctuate from company to company, and like, or job to job for that matter. And I believe that the federal government should take their hands away from that. They shouldn't get to say, no. Someone who calls out from work, I don't know, two or three times a week should also make 12, or 10.10 in this case, or someone who works their fingers to the bone 5 days a week should also make that amount of money. The federal government shouldn't have that kind of say.
Senator Bowman?
Listen. No one is going to be living in excess if we slowly raise our minimum wage to $12 by 2020. Minimum wage goes along with inflation, and every time we've seen an increase in minimum wage, we have seen an increase in the number of jobs created. That's just simple fact. If we want to grow our economy, we need to grow our spending power. How do we grow our spending power? By allowing middle-class Americans to make the purchases that they need for their families, to buy a home for their family. We had the housing crisis in 2007 where people who were hard-working people lost their homes.
We're gonna move on to the next question.
Governor Bowman, though the parties disagree on many things, one thing everyone agrees on is the need to change the tax system. What would tax reform look like during your presidency?
Absolutely. I touched a little bit on this. We need to cut taxes for the middle class, again, to increase our spending power. And going back to those loopholes and excessive exemptions for big corporations. I'm sorry, but I believe that a CEO should not be able to hire a big fancy lawyer and get out of paying taxes. If a CEO is paying less in taxes than his secretary, then we have a fundamental problem. I'm not asking for any crazy, huge taxes. I'm not trying to take money away from the wealthy. I'm just asking for everyone to pay their fair share. That's all I want.
So I'm gonna go ahead and disagree with you, and I think that if a CEO wants to pay for a lawyer, I think he obviously has the right to do so. Like I said, I also touched on this earlier with changing my small business taxes from 19.5 to 15. I believe that with cutting tax on the middle class can help promote growth into our economy. Middle class are the most amount of spenders. That's the highest density population we have in terms of the economy. With more money in their hands means more money circulating in the economy, which means growth, and which means progress.
Thank you, Rebecca. We're going... Thank you, Rebecca. We're going to shift back to foreign policy now. This debate is being held in Florida, the state that has the most interest in our diplomatic relationship with Cuba. Governor Bowman, would you continue President Obama's policies on reconciliation toward the Cuban government?
Listen, I always think that diplomacy should be first, all right? We're not trying to go back to a time where we have enemies across the globe. The way that we can grow our economy is through the global economic structure. So when we do business with other countries, our economy grows. Punishing a country because of what they did however many years ago is outdated. We need to look towards the future. We need to invest in our future. And that's what I'm here tonight to talk about.
I believe that the current plan with Cuba right now is settling, and we're giving in, and we're getting complacent. I don't think we gave in or were complacent with North Korea. We're not giving in or complacent with communist China. I don't believe that if Raul Castro wants to sit here and consider and stay the same and keep Cuba communist, then there's no way we don't negotiate. We can negotiate, but we don't negotiate with regimes like that. Maybe in due time we can be diplomatic and we can make amends, and that's fine. But you're saying we're punishing Cuba right now. By punishing them, we're not allowing them to access the United States economy, United States trade. That's fine. Because within, I want to say, I don't know, closing on 50, 60 years ago, there was a nuclear weapon, an atomic weapon, 90 miles off the coast of this very state. I'm sorry, but I can't agree with somebody who's going to threaten us with that.
Governor Bowman, can you just clarify your response? Are you saying that you would keep the policy of reconciliation toward Cuba the same?
Yes, I am.
Thank you. Senator Franklin, Europe is facing a migrant crisis that is almost unparalleled in world history. Germany's Angela Merkel is coming under fire from critics in Germany and around the EU for assuring that her country would welcome any and all Syrian refugees. Should the United States follow her example and accept more refugees?
The United States can continue to, are you talking about exclusively Syrian or in general?
Can you answer for both?
Okay, yeah, that's fine. I believe if we want to take any refugees, that's fine. You know, this is the land of opportunity, and if they want to come to this country, then I'm all for it. However, they need to come here legally. They need to follow the proper legal channels. If they have their paperwork and decide to come here legally, then that's entirely okay. We've had immigrants from Canada and from Germany who are two of our allies who come here legally with their paperwork, and they get processed and vetted no problem. However, the concept of sanctuary cities is a blatant disregard to the current immigration system that we have now. I'm a firm supporter of Cate's Law, which is going through right now, and I believe that if refugees decided that they want to come to the land of the free and the home of the brave, they're more than welcome to.
When we're talking about asylum seekers who are running away from corruption, from violence, from their families being torn apart, we must look at these people with compassion. Syrian refugees are coming to countries in Europe because they are seeking shelter. Shelter from a problem that we created. And we must be smart about it. We must vet those who we accept to come into the United States. But listen, there are cities in the United States who are opening their arms wide. They are looking on individuals in need with compassion and love. And they're saying, come, we're willing to take you, we're willing to help you, we want you to have the American dream. Who are we as the federal government to tell these cities that they are wrong? Who are we to tell individual families you can't help somebody who needs it?
I think compassion and love are excellent, but at the end of the day, sanctuary cities are unconstitutional, they're illegal, and I mean, what's the point of having laws if you're not going to abide by them?
Oh. to our audience, because we just remember to keep the debate moving, to refrain from applause as often. The Russian presence in Syria is growing. China continues to expand its influence in South China Sea. Is the U.S. losing its place as the world leader on foreign affairs, Governor Bowman?
No, we're not losing our place, and we won't lose our place. When I'm in the White House, I will stand shoulder to shoulder with our allies. I will stand with France. I will make sure that we take the necessary steps to protect America, to protect our children, to protect our future. I am not willing to sacrifice lives so flippantly and the way that we have in the past. I think that we need to focus on our own economy here at home. We need to focus on helping the veterans who are here, who so desperately need efficient health care, who so desperately need to have education, thanks to the GI Bill, which I absolutely support. We are giving that opportunity to the men and women who deserve it most. Our first priority needs to be at home, and foreign relations comes next.
I'm actually going to agree with Governor Bowman here. The United States is not slipping from the world superpower. Right now, Vladimir Putin is air bombing Syria, claiming that he wants to rid the world of ISIS, which, you know, from face value, that sounds fantastic. But I, for one, when I'm in the White House, will hold Putin responsible for all the collateral damage he's done in Syria. Kurds on the ground have done more damage to ISIS and ISIL, or ISIL, however you want to refer to them as, than Syria has from the air. If that's not a statement on how Russia plans to operate in the future, then I don't know what is.
We're going to refer back to Brittany Ganey for some questions on higher education at this time.
The average college student in 2015 will owe $35,000 in student loans, which is up from under $10,000 in 1993. Furthermore, over 70% of college students now owe loans, as opposed to under one half two decades ago. Governor Bowman, do we have a student loan crisis? Who is at fault, and what are the solutions?
Listen, we do have a student loan crisis. We have a crisis of education. And I can tell you because I lived it myself. I put myself through college, but that was so long ago. I had the opportunity to put myself through college because that's the society I lived in that day. I could make enough money to put myself through college. Today, the average student can't. And that's something that we need to address. Student loan debt is through the roof. We need to come up with creative solutions of how we can combat this problem. Now, as far as public institutions go and public universities, we need to make those more accessible. Anybody who wants a higher education and is willing to work for it should be able to access it. I support private universities who want to charge more because they offer a unique experience, and I absolutely stand behind that. But for those who don't have that access, they need an education.
Governor Bowman, you said we need to find a way to combat federal loans and the federal loan crisis, and I completely understand that from the student point. I actually have that answer, and that's privatized loans. Right now, the federal government giving out loans is, again, just federal government dipping their hand way too far where they don't deserve to. Federal loans, student loans, have the highest interest rate of any other loan from the federal government. That is absurd. 9% of four-year college graduates in the past 10 years are unemployed. How do they plan on paying back their student loans? Because they can't. They can't because there's not enough jobs, and they can't because they're too far in debt to even begin to take care of it. So they go back to school and they get themselves more in debt, and it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Ultimately, to answer your question, it's the federal government's fault for getting this involved in the higher education system.
So to combat loans, you are proposing a different kind of loan. I don't agree with that. I do not think that we need to encourage student loan debt. I think that we need to make higher education more accessible. And you know how we're going to do that? We're going to do that through a tax on legal recreational marijuana, because you know what? Why not? We can generate over the billions of dollars that we can generate through this will allow students to access education. It will help us to work to make sure that substance abuse and mental health people have the ability to access the health care that they need. We need a better health care system. We need a system that we need drastic change, because what we're doing isn't working. And sure, you can laugh, but listen, this is what we need.
What you just said had nothing to do with privatized loans or federal loans for that matter. I believe the issue with federal loans, snowball. I'm not replacing one loan with another. I'm replacing one loan that decides to self-destruct and make itself worth three or four times more than its actual worth within 5 years versus a privatized loan, which is, you said it yourself, the private sector has more than enough money to give around.
Okay. We're gonna move on to the next question now.
Thank you.
Senator Franklin, according to the Gallup study, only half of college graduates believe that their education was worth the cost and effort to obtain their degree. With this in mind, is higher education system broken?
We have too much social pressure for students to go to college and get this type of job or that type of job. Like I said earlier, I'm a firm believer that college could not be for everyone. We need more incentives and more introductions to vocational schools and technical schools. These are careers that are slowly dying. They're slowly being eliminated from the entire American economy because people aren't being introduced to them anymore. There's too much of a pressure from families, from societies, to just say, look, you need to go to college, you need to make this much money, you need to do this. But there's still an income from all of these jobs that are not being taken. These are opportunities that are being taken away because people aren't being introduced to them. And what is America without opportunity?
I understand that. We do need individuals in trade schools, but in order to compete in the global economy, we need research. We need innovation. We need to be investing in new technology. We need to be investing in our students from the moment that they start pre-K until they achieve the level of education that they want. Master's degrees, doctor's degrees. We need to have the level of education available because we can do it. It's not that we as Americans lack the intellectual capacity, but for some reason, we're still 24th in the PISA scores. We are falling behind. We need to encourage education. We need to make it more accessible. We need to allow students who are willing to go and work hard be able to achieve all of their dreams. That's what the American dream is. You work hard and you accomplish your goals.
However, we don't need the pressures of needing to achieve master's degrees or bachelor's degrees and everything. We need diversity in education. These are opportunities we're missing out on. You know there are 6% of students with master's degrees that do not have jobs. That is 6% of students who could have explored something else if it wasn't for the social pressures on them.
We're going to go ahead and move on to the next question.
The president and chancellor of the University of Missouri resigned this week as a result of a hunger strike by an African-American graduate student. He was protesting what he perceived to be a hostile environment for minorities on campus. Some of the complaints include students using racial slurs and drawing swastikas in dorms. Senator Franklin, is it a university's charge to ensure that all students feel comfortable at the possible expense of absolute freedom of speech?
Absolutely. I think the university, if a student is going to pay however much they're going to pay to attend a university, they are more or less an employee of that university. They're getting the same benefits that the university has to offer through the education and any other opportunities. But if you are paying that much, you can't do these kinds of acts. If they're a private institution or even a public institution, if you are a higher education program in the United States, you can't tolerate that kind of behavior. It's no different from the terrible backlash that the Black Lives Matter movement has had, which has come from a gap between police operation and the actual movement itself, which in that situation, we need to bridge the gap. We need to start from small town and community policing all the way back up, which in the example of Missouri, it's the same thing. We need to start from the connection between employees on campus and student to student by themselves.
Governor Bowman.
I'm deeply saddened by the events that have happened, and I am also encouraged to see that action was taken. Unfortunately, threats of violence should never occur on an institution of higher learning. And the same can be said for the Black Lives Matter movement. I agree with you. And as the wife of a black man and the mother of a mixed child, I am especially close to this issue. I think about my daughter when she's at school. I think about what I would want her to be facing when she is at her institution of higher learning. We have a systematic problem of race in our country. And the attention that is being given to it is good.
Thank you, Brittany. We're gonna move back to Rebecca Masano, and she will ask some questions about some important social issues.
A federal appeals court ruled this week that President Obama's executive action to provide work permits and shield undocumented immigrants from deportation exceeded his constitutional authority. Governor Bowman, if you're elected, what would you continue to pursue the policy outlined by the current administration?
Yes, because we need to bring 11 million undocumented workers out of the shadows. These are people who contribute to our economy in a great way. And what they contribute is valuable. Unfortunately, there are not everyone who is in this country should be, because they have committed crimes, and some of those crimes are violent crimes. But I would say that the majority of undocumented workers in the United States are here because they want a better life for their family, because they are escaping corruption, because they are escaping persecution. And I think that we need to work with Mexico. We need to work with the countries diplomatically to figure out why these people are coming here. What are they escaping?
It's almost a double-edged sword that America is the land of opportunity, because we have situations like this where people are stuck between a rock and a hard place and would like to come to America. However, I said it myself earlier, laws are laws, and if you don't enforce them, why do they exist? If refugees want to make their way to the United States, like I said before, they are more than welcome to. However, they need to be properly vetted and properly given a proper background check, because otherwise it's the liability that you're taking. I understand they're coming from an absolutely terrible war-torn area, but at the end of the day, this is still our home too. We are inviting them into our home, but does everyone understand the threat that you would do if you don't properly vet these people? If you don't properly background check all of these people? Because at the end of the day, if they want to be Americans, that's great, but they still need to abide by what we have to say.
Absolutely, but clumping immigrant workers all together in a group, in one specific group, is wrong. My parents are Polish immigrants. They came here with a dream, and I saw that dream. I am a product of that American dream. And while we may want to stigmatize those who come here illegally, we need to understand why they are coming here. We need to understand the incredible role that they play in our economy. Undocumented workers are doing that. They are working. They are working so that we can have a bigger, better economy. And that's what's happening. Unfortunately, some of this is getting lost in translation.
We're going to go ahead and move on to the next question.
Senator Franklin, we're spending over $50 billion each year on the war on drugs, and it's led to an incarceration rate that leads the world. Given the cost, has this effort been successful? Would you maintain the status quo drug policy as president?
We're leading the world in incarceration rates. I'm sorry about that, because our numbers have doubled since 1985 in the United States legal system, and that's because that we have these fickle legal here, not legal there laws for things like marijuana. Is it federally legal? Is it legal in this state? Is it legal recreationally in this state or medically? I believe the federal government should have one say, and that is medical marijuana should be legal. In terms of recreation, I personally can't support that. That should be a state-by-state right, but I know that I cannot go home to my children and look them in the face and say that a drug that was not okay yesterday is now okay today.
Governor Bowman, given the seemingly fragile state of the world economy, to what lengths should government go to combat climate change?
If I could address
the
last question.
Yes, would you like to rebut on the last
question? Yes, absolutely. In the United States, we will save billions of dollars if we stop the unjust incarceration of nonviolent drug offenders. We need to provide health care for those who have substance abuse. But for the rest of Americans, medical marijuana can be helpful. I have seen loved ones who have had cancer, who have had other diseases, and medical marijuana has eased their pain. Recreational marijuana is no more dangerous than alcohol. And once we end the prohibition of marijuana, we will have a better system overall. We won't be wasting billions of dollars in the incarceration of young people and minorities. A black man is 8 times more likely to be arrested than his white counterpart for medical for marijuana possession. That's
We're
a problem.
We're going to go ahead and move on to the next question now. Thank you.
Do you have anything you want to say back to that?
Yeah, I want to address the fact that medical marijuana obviously can help. It helps with rheumatoid arthritis. It can help you with Crohn's disease, colitis, cancer. It can help across the board. However, that is also regulated. That is also has an eye kept on it. Recreational marijuana, it's called a gateway drug for a reason. And that's all I have to say on that. Thank you.
Okay. Now on to the next question. Governor Bowman, given the seemingly fragile state of the world's economy, to what length should government go to combat climate change?
Climate change is real. Climate change exists, and there are man-made pollutants that are making it worse. I don't care about this simply because a scientist tells me to care about it. I care about it because I care about the future of my daughter. I care about it because this is the future of our, not only of our country, but of our world, and we must take it seriously. We need to invest in sustainable energy. We need to invest in sustainable resources. Oil works well for now, but if we levy a tax and use that money to fund research so that we can preserve our world, so that we can preserve our country, we would be doing our children a great justice.
My operation on the Keystone Pipeline would help open up jobs in the energy sector and create, I want to say the number was $17 billion in revenue. However, I do agree that climate change is a problem. Climate change has been addressed for the past 15 years. What we need to do is stop wasting money on addressing the problems and start using our money, our American taxpaying money, to start dealing with those problems. We understand the polar ice caps are melting. We understand we have global warming and global cooling. But we need to stop wasting our time and all this money and say, look, roll up our sleeves and say, this is how we're going to combat this, instead of just walking around the idea and calling it something different every year.
So do you
Next
support?
Question, please.
Senator Franklin, if you're elected, will you continue to empower the NSA with the surveillance powers they have accrued over the previous two administrations?
Absolutely not. I feel that the NSA, with the powers they have right now and the lack of limitations, is very unconstitutional, and it's an invasion of privacy. The fact that the federal government can find out that anything that you are calling or you're taking a picture of or you're texting from your personal cell phone is an invasion of privacy. At that point, they understand every nook and cranny in your own home. I think that the NSA should stick to what they are, and that's a national security agency and not a peeping Tom from the federal government, from the White House.
I believe that we need to keep America safe, but at the same time, I understand that in the Constitution, we have rights. We have rights to freedom. We have rights to privacy. And when the government infringes upon that, it becomes a problem. We do need to be able to gather intelligence against those who would want to do us harm. But when we just go after regular American citizens and monitor their calls and monitor their emails, we're not doing anyone any good. We need more efficient ways of combating terror, of combating those who would want to do us harm. And I agree that simply monitoring average Joe's phone calls is not going to help us accomplish any of that. We need to streamline our intelligence between the FBI, between the CIA, between our allies in Europe.
So you agree that it's okay to get information from Americans, but it's not okay to get information from people that are blatantly ignoring our legal system to come into this country, our immigration system? So it's not okay to get information from them, but it's all right to get information from Americans.
Those who desperately need help, I will not close the door and slam it in their face when they're escaping persecution.
Oh, there's no slamming the door. It's just asking them to turn the knob. Thank you.
We're going to go ahead and move along.
Governor Bowman, if you were elected, would you sign legislation that alters the Affordable Care Act in any way?
Yes, absolutely. Do I think the Affordable Care Act is perfect? No. In no way, shape, or form is it perfect. We have seniors who often have to choose between if they're going to eat dinner tonight or if they're going to pay for their prescription drugs. There's something inherently wrong with that. I believe that healthcare is a right. Healthcare is a human right. And we need to work towards a single payer system so that we can encourage our children to be taken care of, those who need it most. And we will ultimately benefit our economy when we do this, because the more people who are paying into insurance, the less expensive it is, the less risk that is involved when somebody who is uninsured seeks help at the hospital, and then the taxpayers have to pick up that bill. That's not right.
I feel that the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare is another chance where the federal government is saying, look, you know, this is what's going to happen right now, and you don't really have much of a say. Obamacare is taking away the American jobs from healthcare providers and the American opportunity to say, no, I want this coverage or I want this coverage. It's taking away individuality in America. It's taking away choice. At the end of the day, Obamacare and healthcare, it's fantastic to have healthcare at the end of the day, but it's not fair to look every American in the face and say, this is yours now, you don't have a say. This is what's going to happen. It's the bare minimum of healthcare, and it's not giving Americans the opportunity to say, no, I want a more expensive one because of XYZ. Because look, I maybe might have a terminal disease and I would like this healthcare instead. But the federal government obviously doesn't seem to think that way or care.
Those who can afford their own healthcare are encouraged to use private insurers.
Okay. Thank you, Rebecca, for those questions. Senator Franklin, this past Wednesday was Veterans Day. With wait times at veteran hospitals showing little sign of decreasing, at an average of 22 veterans taking their own lives a day, and a variety of other issues, what is the most important problem facing veterans today, and how would your administration fix it?
That statistic that you just said is absolutely abysmal, and that breaks my heart to hear that. And as a veteran, I understand the importance of VA programs and VA hospitals, and my administration would make sure that those VA programs and those VA facilities have way more funding than they have right now, because it's not fair. If you can't afford to send soldiers to war, then don't send them at all. We need to make sure that they are taken care of and that they have their rights just like every other American. Those people give the ultimate sacrifice at the end of the day, and they come back and they're given the ultimate disrespect. And I don't think that's fair anymore. I believe that Americans should recognize that these people are doing anything necessary to make sure that we back home in the mainland of the United States are as secure as possible. Like I said, I think my administration should spend a lot more time funding these VA programs as well as investing new ways to take care of their mental health issues.
Absolutely, I agree with you 100%. We need to have the strongest military the world has ever known. We need to be well equipped. We need to be ready to take on any challenge that comes our way. But at the same time, when those veterans come home, we need to take care of them. The VA needs a complete overhaul, and I have assigned my vice president to that mission. We need to make sure that that veterans are receiving the proper dental care, are receiving the proper mental health care, and PTSD can be treated with the proper treatment that needs to be made available to them. Unfortunately, under this current system, the wait times are too long. It's simply inefficient. Veteran homelessness should not even be an issue. We should not see statistics that say every 80 minutes a veteran takes his own life. That is not okay. And we do need to change it immediately. I'm glad that we can agree on that.
During his failed run for the GOP nomination, Donald Trump hoped that if one thing came from his campaign, it would be that he hoped that the influence of special interests would be curtailed in the future. Governor Bowman, do you believe you have the credibility to lead this fight?
Absolutely, and I support the repeal of Citizens United. I believe that we need transparency in our elections. I believe that the American citizens should have a vote and have their vote count when it comes to who is elected. Special interests can be dangerous, and the American people need to have their voice heard. When we have special interests like military contractors or pharmaceutical companies, then we have an inherent problem. I believe that the more transparency that can be achieved in elections, the better. And I stand behind this, and I always have.
I believe right now that absolutely no one in the United States in terms of politics should be given a special interest. I was not raised a white collar politician like these, like the people I'm surrounded myself with in Congress. It's funny that you mentioned transparency, because I personally do agree. I believe we should have transparent votes. And I was taught that if you wanted something done, you didn't blackmail someone behind closed doors. If you wanted something, you earned it and you made sure you worked for it.
Senator Franklin, what weight should the public give to a candidate's values, morals, when determining whom to support?
They should take everything into account when thinking about who to support. So if they absolutely know Americans should go in blind and saying, oh, you know, I'm a Democrat or I'm a Republican, so I'm only voting for a Democrat or I'm only voting for a Republican, because that's the problem that America has today. It's too black and white in terms of its politics. We need many shades of gray, because there are many shades of gray in terms of interests. At the end of the day, like I said, I think every single voter should take every single situation, every single avenue, every single option into account when looking at candidates. So let's say somebody appreciates Ronald Reagan for what he had to do in foreign affairs but doesn't agree with him domestically, then I think there should be another party that understands where this person's coming from, because I bet you that person is not alone.
Thank you. Governor Bowman?
I think that integrity is not something that comes in shades of gray. I think that it's something that you either stand for the morals and principles that you say you stand for, or you don't. And that's how I've always run my campaign. I will always say what I support and what I don't support. There was a recent bill that came to my attention to defund Planned Parenthood, and I made it clear that I would not stand behind that vote. And I made it clear to the sponsor of the bill that I would not stand behind that vote because of my own morals and my own principles that led me to believe that a woman has a right to her own body, and that Roe versus Wade is a law of the land. And regardless whatever my moral, religious feelings may be, I understand that everyone should have the right to their own body.
I just want to say that obviously I'm sure you did make it very, very clear to the person who proposed the bill, and that's great, but you did not make it clear to the American people. And I agree with you that integrity does not come in shades of gray. It comes in black and it comes in white, but it also does not come in closed doors. Thank you.
We're going to move into our final question of the evening. What do you know now that you wish you knew before you started your campaign? Governor Bowman, would you go first?
Sure. I wish I knew how rewarding this process would be. I wish I knew the beautiful people that I would get to meet while on this campaign trail. I wish that I had met someone like Andrea, who is transgender, and came to me saying, please, we need the Equality Act. I need to be free in my workplace. I cannot be thrown out of another apartment because of who I am. Listening to these stories has made me so grateful for this opportunity. And as your president, I will continue to fight for these rights. I will make it clear of what I stand for and what I want for the American people. I believe that together we can achieve greatness. But I can't do it alone. I am a representation of you and your values. And I ask you to vote for the person who reflects you.
Had I known then what I know now about starting this campaign, I would have known, or I would have taken a different approach to, Americans don't feel like their voice is heard anymore. Americans think, oh, between the Electoral College and just the masses themselves, that one vote doesn't matter. One vote always matters. In the early 20th century, Americans felt the same way, that their voice was not being heard. You know what happened? We introduced the 16th Amendment, which is the direct election of senators. That was another avenue where the Americans decided that our voice should be heard right now. I think at the end of the day, every vote counts. Every American needs to know that this is a constitutional right for you to elect who's going to represent you across the globe and who's going to represent you and your issues at home.
It's now time for candidates to deliver their closing statements. Governor Bowman.
Thank you. Again, I just want to thank St. Leo for having us here tonight. Thank you, moderators. As your president, I will enact change. And perhaps for some, this change will be drastic, but it is needed. We need to ensure the future of our children. We need to grow our economy. We need to ensure that everyone is guaranteed equality, regardless of race, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of sexual identity. I reflect the views of the future of America. I don't want to go back to a time in our past. I want to build a better future for America. I want to take us forward. I don't want to take us back into the past, because all that we've seen is heartache from the past, and we see bright horizons in the future.
Tonight, we've all heard what my administration, as well as Governor Bowman's administration, have planned for the future of America. Right now, right or wrong, better or for worse, these aren't really relevant. What matters most right now is necessity and what America needs. We need education reform. We need economic stability and international security. These are the foundations of American pride. And with these, we'll be able to succeed. It's not on me and it's not on you, but it is on us together to accomplish this. Henry Beecher is quoted saying that liberty is the soul's right to breathe, and when it cannot take a long breath, laws are girded too tight. Laws that Governor Bowman still feels like they have another notch in their belt to go. You spoke a lot about yourself tonight, Governor Bowman, and that's great. There is definitely an I in America, but there is no I in we the people. Thank you.
On behalf of the moderators, candidates, and St. Leo University, we thank you for attending this debate.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask our candidates to please take a seat. It's time to vote. I'm almost disappointed in asking you to take your phones and use them for voting, because I was just watching, and our debate is trending in the top 100 trends on Twitter right now. So, well done to all of you. For those of you that missed the vice presidential debate going on Twitter, it was pretty good, so well done. We are gonna, right now you're getting passed out some cards that will tell you how to vote. You need to go to sli.do. And when you go there, you will be asked to put in a code, a number. It's just a four-digit number, 7395. Again, that's coming on the cards that are coming around right now. So you go to sli.do, you will put in the number 7395, and you will be able to vote for one of the candidates. I'm sorry, for the partners, Rachel Bowman and Chris Sampson, running on the Democrat ticket, and Chuck Franklin and Elizabeth Chase running on the Republican ticket. You will be able to vote for one of those right now. If, for any reason, you get an error message, we only have bandwidth in this room for about 150 to 180 people, and we have more than that here, so keep trying, but you can only vote once. And keep in mind, there are people off-site watching this right now as we stream it that are also voting. So every vote really does matter and really does count here tonight. While you're voting, while this is tabulating, and I'm just gonna ask Greg text me when we have the results, okay? While that's happening, I do want to very quickly tear down the fourth wall just for a moment here and recognize our participants. Dr. Lennox had mentioned three of the programs that we've been working with. There are actually seven that have put this on here tonight. So first of all, yeah, round of applause, all the students. Thank you. The first thing I would like to do, I have been a part of seven alternate reality learning experiences, and this by far has been the best. And it has been the best because the faculty that worked on this were tremendous. So just very quickly, can I have all the faculty who participated with their classes in this experience, will you please stand up? Give them a round of applause, please. Students who were in one of the nine sections, from criminal justice to education to psychology to social media and marketing to political science to, let's see, communication, there you go, to, I said social media, I forget anybody, psychology, please stand up if you're in one of those classes. All right, well done, well done. So the voting is only going to remain open for about 30 more seconds. Yeah? Yeah? You need longer? It's not letting you in? Keep trying. Are you good? All right. Come on. I want to thank you all for all that you've done, but it is time to announce the winner from these tabulated votes. Don't you wish it actually worked this fast? Candidates, will you please stand up? With a narrow margin of victory, I am proud to present the next President of the United States, Mr. Chuck Franklin. To both of the candidates, thank you so much. It was a wonderful debate. I loved hearing about the medical marijuana. I think that was about when Dr. Lennon started feeling really uncomfortable, so well done. We will have a recap and thank you dinner for the students. You'll hear more about that in your classes on Mondays. Thank you, everybody. Have a great weekend. Congratulate the new president.
I was born and raised in a small town in Ohio by a middle-class family. My mother was a teacher, and my father was a factory worker. So I grew up knowing a lot about what it means to be an average American. I've had to work hard to be where I am today because I believe that's the American way. Every day, we are faced with new challenges to overcome. And as your president, I will see these challenges as opportunities to build a better future for America. I'm Rachel Bowman, and I approve this message.